Well, hello, Joni. How are you?
Good. It's great to be here with you.
And I am just so thrilled that you are here today. Joni Ames is a personal friend, and Joni did her first conference with me with Glow International. She travels all over this nation. She's written many articles with the Elijah List, with Morningstar Ministries. She has ministered to House of Prayer as well. And she ministers prophetically. And I have to tell you, every word that she has spoken, it is to the dotting of the I and the crossing of the T in accuracy. And you just can't get any better than that. So tell us, Joni Ames, a little bit about you.
Well, it's really interesting because I never expected to be in ministry. I was just a single mother working for other ministries. I moved to the Carolinas in 1985 to work at PTL and worked there from the time I got there until after it closed down. And then I worked for Morris Cirillo when he came in, and then went to work at a radio station in Charlotte owned by Jimmy Swaggart. At that station, I met a man that was helping Rick Joyner start his ministry. I've been with Morningstar in one way or another ever since then, and that was 1990. Then I went to work also for Central Church of God in Charlotte as the singles administrator for 1,500 singles. And then Derek Prince moved his ministry to Charlotte, and I worked as the executive assistant to the U.S. director. And so I was just so used to being a helper type of a person, a support person, administrative assistant, and so forth, and just never was looking towards doing my own ministry. But God began to open doors as Morningstar began to grow, because I was on their prophetic teams. Mm-hmm. And then Bonnie Mahesh Chavda moved their ministry to Charlotte and asked me to help them to raise up their prophetic teams. And I started getting invitations to minister at churches all over the country. And that's what I've been doing now for 25 years.
Why did you always feel that you had a call to ministry? You said,
well, one thing that I knew was that I had a prophetic gift. And so I would just know things, or I would have dreams. Even as a small child, I would have dreams and they would come true. I would have a vision and it would come to pass by the end of the day.
Well, could you tell the people, you talked about, you used the word prophetic. Not everybody knows what that word means. So could you define what the prophetic is and prophecy?
Sure. Well, for one thing, it's not what a lot of people think. They think that it has to be just some amazing experience where a light comes from heaven and you hear this big, loud, booming voice and that type of thing. And so many people tell me, oh, I'm not prophetic at all. But when I train people in the prophetic, one of the things I like to do is to bring out the fact that it's simply hearing the voice of God. And Jesus said that his sheep know his voice. Mm. We can all hear his voice.
Yes, yes.
And what it does is it comes in such a natural way. Mm-hmm. It's the small, still voice of the Lord in our spirit, speaking to us in a very loving way, in a very sometimes quiet way. And the other thing is there is prophetic words also, mm-hmm, that are forth-telling. Mm-hmm. And that's another thing as well. But when I'm talking about the prophetic, I like to think of it simply as hearing the voice of God. Mm-hmm. And I do want to make a difference here, because the prophetic words in the Bible are oath level. They will come to pass no matter whether anybody believes it or not.
Amen.
But a personal prophetic word for someone is often contingent on our obedience, or even the obedience of people you're involved with, mm-hmm, and that type of thing. You can have a notebook full of prophetic words, but if you don't do anything about it, nothing will happen, mm-hmm, because faith without works is dead. Mm-hmm. And, in 1 Timothy 4, 13 through 16, it says to meditate on these things and, mm-hmm, give yourself entirely to them, yeah, so that your, yeah, progress will be evident, yeah, to all.
Well, I remember you told me a long time ago, the Lord gave you one word, and it was a prophetic word. It was when you were stepping out in the prophetic. And it was one word. It was about love. And I was so amazed with that one word, and she talked about it, and she got up to give that word of the Lord, and the Lord was speaking through her, saying that how much that he loved this person, and that one word was for that person. So I want to encourage you in stepping out in the things of God. One word can make a difference.
Can change a person's entire life. And just to kind of explain what happened there is that we had a lot of visitors that came to our church back in that day. Mm-hmm. And there were fewer of us than there were the visitors. And so my pastor called all the visitors up front, and there was about 300, and there was about 30 of us, and he said, so there's about 10 to 1, and, you know, I want you to go to someone that you feel drawn to and give them a word.
Yeah.
And then go on to the next one, and after you, you know, meaning the people that were being ministered to, have been ministered to, go sit down. And I saw this one lady, and she looked like she had it all together and everything, and I just heard in my spirit, in that small, still voice, like I'm talking about it, God loves you. And I'm like, of course he does. He loves everybody. That's not a word. I want names, dates, places, you know. But that's too small of a word. I don't want to give that. And plus that, I'd be embarrassed. She probably has known the Lord all her life, you know. And my pastor came to the microphone, and he said, the Lord just said that one of my people told him he gave them too small of a word. But if you don't give that word, he's not going to give you anything else. Because if you're not faithful with a little, why should he give you anything bigger? And so, very embarrassed, I went to this lady and said, you know, I'm sorry, it's just a small word. Actually, it's just three words. And you can go to somebody else after me. You don't have to go sit down because it's so small. But, you know, my pastor, who he was talking about was me. And so I have to be faithful and give this, or God won't give me anything else. And so I just looked at her and I said, so anyway, God said to, and I was laughing, God said to tell you he loves you. And this woman screamed and she fell to the ground crying. And anyway, the bottom line was, come to find out, that her husband had died and she had wanted to die because he had died. He'd been the only man she ever dated all the years of her life. She had a 16-year-old daughter and a 19-year-old son when he passed. And she hadn't been a good mom since then. It had been 4 years. And she had told the Lord when she came across this bridge that's in between North and South Carolina, when she came across that bridge to come to our meeting, she said, you know, nobody loves me. And I'm going to a prophetic place tonight. And if somebody there doesn't tell me that you love me, God, when I come back, I'm going to drive off of this bridge and end it all. And so those three words, God loves you, saved her life. And she had been in church, you know, all her life and everything else. She knew the Lord, but at that point of her life, she didn't feel like God loved her. And so I just learned from that, that it's so important to be obedient to the Lord, and just how important it is, even for something that small, to be given to someone when God gives it to you.
Well, speaking of that, Joni, being that you are a prophetess, what word would you have to say for America?
I believe we're at a real crossroads right now, a real time when things can go either way. And I believe that the Lord has said that he has put his plumb line in America once again, and that it's the word of God, and that we have a choice. I believe he's calling us as Christians into responsibility and accountability for the things that we say and do, as well as that even includes voting. And that we as responsible Christians need to be sure that we're putting people in office that stand for the word of God.
Yes.
I'm not talking about Democrat, Republican, whatever they stand for. And that we're responsible. If we put someone in office that stands for abortion, we're responsible for all the abortions that happen during their term in office. And so it's so important for us to vote, even to vote in a righteous way. And the other thing is that I believe we're in the time period, just like what Jesus spoke about in Matthew 24, where he said there would be worse times than ever before, or ever more would be. He warns that there would even be false prophets, you know, false ministers, and that if possible, even the very elect would be deceived.
Yeah.
And that there's so much deception out there, and that we need to be ever so cautious of what we take into our spirits and what we let out. You know, one time recently, I was watching television, and I was watching a comedy program on television. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden, the Lord came into my room, and I saw his arm go past me, and he pointed towards the television. And he said, "That wasn't funny." And I'm like, "What, Lord, what?" And he said again, "That wasn't funny." Mm-hmm. And I said, "God, what are you talking about?" And he said, "It's television programs just like that that are the reason that many young people have no respect for male authority, because the television programs nowadays are making men look weak, stupid, and as if they don't even have a brain in their head." And he says, "And that was not funny." Mm-hmm. But he said, "There's about to come a movement, a men's movement, that will be bigger even than the Promise Keepers movement."
Yes,
and
Lord.
Again, once again, it will be like David's mighty men being brought forth.
Yes.
And he said, there are groups of 5, sometimes 10, sometimes 20, even now that are beginning to gather. And they don't look like much, just like David's mighty men didn't look too mighty in the beginning.
Right.
You know, the Bible says they were all discouraged, in debt, and in despair. He said, but they became the mighty men. And he says, there are many mighty men out there right now that are beginning to gather together. And you're going to see the churches more full with men in this season than you ever have. Mm-hmm. And he says, but I am bringing my men forth.
What would you say to America regarding women?
You know, I believe that he has for some time been raising up his Psalm 68:11, great company, great host of women. And when it says there, the company of women, it means feminine army. And so he.
Ooh, I like that. You hear that? Feminine army.
That's right. His
warrior women.
Warriors for such a time as this. And there's another scripture that says, and a woman shall surround a man. And I believe that we, as these warrior women, are going to begin to surround our men, whether it's our fathers, our sons, brothers, or pastors, or whoever. And we're going to surround them in prayer and keep them safe from harm. Mm-hmm. Our president, even, and that God has called us to that. And I also believe that he has many women that he's bringing forth for such a time as this. Even that scripture says, by the way, to publish his good news.
Yes,
and the Lord
yes.
said, in a literal sense, he's bringing forth an army of women to publish, literally publish his good news mm-hmm. across the internet, as well as in books and so forth, to teach and to train others. And he showed me women who would send out a word on the internet on one side of the world, and on the other side of the world, a woman in a burqa would read it, and the burqa would melt right off of her. And so that there are many women who have golden nuggets on the inside of them, and don't just keep them in you. Don't just write things in a book. You know, a lot of us make journals and everything, but begin to write those articles and send them out, because, and it's not, doesn't cost you anything, you know, normally, to do something like that. There are free blogs all over the place that you can do, and to begin to send those things out. That's how he started my ministry out. That is actually how started out.
That's right.
I was too shy to talk in front of people, so he had me write.
Yes.
And I started out writing blogs and sending them out.
Well, so what about this Joshua generation that God is raising up for this hour?
You mean the young people?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, well, I just want to say this. Many people have focused on the young people, and I truly believe that there is a group of young people that he's raising up. But I believe the over 50s group has kind of been shoved in the background. But God said we need the over 50s to raise up the young people, to raise up the Joshuas.
Amen.
And that it's going to be a together kind of a thing. And that the over 50s group, who have even, you know, pulled themselves back and hidden away, mm-hmm. need to come forth for such a time as this.
Yes.
Have the Bible studies in the college campuses. Have the young people over to your home for a meal, and just to get to know them and to help to mother and father them. Because we have a couple, 2-3 generations that haven't really been parented. But God says he has his people in place to reparent those in this season, so that they will not be lost.
That's a good word, Johnny. That's a really good word. So what do you sense that the Lord is saying in the days that we are in? A now word.
Well, like I said, I do believe it's important for us to be involved politically. You know, it's been a lie when it's been said that the church should stay out of the business of the political arena. Even the letter that was written, it wasn't a law, it was a letter that spoke about separation of church and state. Mm. And that, you know, the government is to work for us. America was founded on the Word of God, and I believe we've got to get back to that. I believe that the church itself needs to get out of the mode of people-pleasing and get back to God-pleasing and speaking forth the word, that there are things that we've kind of lost. You know, churches aren't even teaching about the baptism of the Holy Spirit or baptism in water, for that matter. Most churches aren't. And that we've got to get back to our foundations, and that as we do, we're going to see a mighty move of God come forth. And the other thing is to get out into the highways and byways and compel them to come in. Yes. Because to do otherwise, what makes us think they're going to come into the church? Mm-hmm. They're not going to come in until they're saved. And with that type of thinking, it's kind of like fishing in a boat with your line inside the boat. You're not going to catch anything. But it's like Jesus said, to cast the net on the other side, and then we'll bring in the big haul. And so I believe that's why, too, the marketplace ministry type of, thing is coming more into play in this time period. The teaching that Lance Wall now does about the seven mountains.
Yes.
It's going into every area and find out what's your specialty. God may call you specifically to minister to people in the sports arena.
That's right.
Or he may call you specifically to minister to people that are in entertainment, or any of the areas that,
or education,
government. They'll call you as a teacher so that you're praying over the young people and causing them to see the light of the Lord in you and come to Him. And so find out where it is that God is leading you and go for it in that arena.
Joni, why don't you speak to the educators right now? Because I know we have a lot of educators who are listening right now. And why don't you speak into their lives? Because that's where the heart and the mind is being formed. And it's such an important mountain.
Absolutely. If you are a teacher, if you are called to the teacher field, God has you there for a reason. Even if it's just to pray for those that you see. But I believe that He's called you there to be a light shining in a dark place and to be one that God uses to bring in a big haul in the Joshua generation. Mm. And I would also just say this, don't speak against any generation. You know, there's a lot of people speaking curse words, you might say, over millennials and so forth. Mm-hmm. And every generation has its defining points.
That's
for sure.
Right.
But every generation has its purpose. Mm-hmm. And God has you where you're at and working with the people that He has you working with, the young people that He has you working with, to help to build them up and put them into place. And not just in a religious way, but also even to give them hope in this time period in a hopeless world.
Yes.
And we can do that. We can even prophesy to someone without saying, "Thus saith the Lord," you know?
Right.
You can look at someone and say, "You know, I just see that you have such and such a gift, or you have such a heart for politics, or you have such a heart for music," or whatever it might be, "and you're going to do well," or "you have such an amazing artistic gift," and encourage them in the areas of gifting that you see in them and help them to find their spot. Even in the workplace.
Yes.
And so don't think that you're useless where you are, because you're not. You are called there. You are ordained to be there from the Lord. You are anointed to be there. And God will bring forth great fruit.
Yes, yes, yes.
Through
yes.
you. You know, and I just want to say, whatever it is God's called you to do, whether it is as a teacher, whether it's a hairdresser, or whatever place He has you in, you are on assignment there, and it's not for nothing. Waiting on tables. God has you in that place for a reason.
In every dimension, He wants to use you. He wants to activate you. He wants to use you for such a time as this. He's raising you up for such a time as this. And He wants you to move forward. And the Lord would say to you, not to look backward, quit looking in that rear view mirror, but look forward, because it's time for you to advance for the kingdom. Amen.
Amen.
Such an exciting time we're living in.
It is.
Share with the people. You understood you went to House of Prayer in Missouri, the main campus. Share about what God is doing.
Well, you know, one thing I believe in is cross-pollinating with all the streams. And when I went to the House of Prayer over 20 years ago, I happened to be there when they first began. It was on Mother's Day 20 years ago. And my heart was just wrecked for the vision of the House of Prayer. And
Yes. They
also had Shiloh, which was a prophetic retreat.
Yes.
And so I moved there for a whole year just to learn all about what they were doing.
Mm-hmm.
And I have carried that with me ever since. And I go back two or three times a year to minister in that region and
mm-hmm.
always go and spend time there. But the Lord spoke to me years ago and He said, worship is your warship.
Did you hear that? She said, worship is your warship.
Amen. And so I believe, you know, when we worship, the Word tells us that He inhabits the praises of His people. And that's a major key. You know, even David would go and play musical instruments
yes.
around Saul to chase away the evil spirits.
Yes.
And the other thing is I have noticed that when I'm ministering somewhere and we have prophetic prayer teams and worship teams, that is when the level of prophetic anointing comes even higher.
That's right.
And it's really a season now, by the way, back to speaking about the House of Prayer. You know, the Word says that the only tabernacle that would be restored is the tabernacle of David.
Yeah.
And the House of Prayer model that is being done out there is that is from the tabernacle of David. Now, there's also a governmental part of the tabernacle of David, but they are producing what is the portion of the tabernacle
yes.
of David
yes.
that is
yes.
the prayer, praise, and worship.
Yes.
And it's so important for this time. I believe that there are over 3,000 prayer houses that have been raised up since they began, and there's more that are needed all over the world.
Well, it's a movement.
Absolutely.
I mean, it's a movement that God is orchestrating.
Right.
And I've just never seen anything like it. We were just in D.C. and we were at David's tent, and we were watching what God was doing there. And
okay.
there's nothing but prayer and adoration to the Lord and declaration of His Word. And you know, Joni, what was so beautiful was we saw such a balance, because I did see older people there. I saw young people there. I saw all different ages, and they were moving together as one. And I believe that that's what the Lord is doing in this hour.
Right.
He wants to activate each and every one of us into our giftings and our callings and our destiny.
You know, another thing is that I believe that this is a new season. We have really been focused on the prophetic for a long time,
mm-hmm.
and the evangelist has been shoved in the background.
True.
But the prophetic words that have been coming forth is there's going to be a billion soul harvest. There's going to be
yes.
stadiums full of people
yes.
coming to
yes.
the Lord. And so I believe this is a time when God is calling the evangelist again.
Mm-hmm.
And that the prophetic is there, that the prophetic people are to begin to point the evangelist towards the fields
yes.
that are ready for harvest.
Yes.
And as we work together, not separately or one
mm-hmm.
trying to be the star of the show or
mm-hmm.
anything like that, but as we work together, that's how we'll see that billion soul harvest. Because we also need them then to have pastors that'll help to raise them
yes.
up. We need teachers to help them, help to train them
mm-hmm.
in what they're called to do. And
mm-hmm.
we need our apostolic fathers and mothers to oversee and to help to raise each one up into their calling
yes.
as well.
Absolutely.
So it's a new season, I believe, of the full fivefold ministry coming forth for such a time as this.
This has just been Absolutely incredible. Now, Joni, you have a book that you've written. It is called The Definitive Guide to the Prophetic. Where can we get that book?
Amazon sells it. I believe you can also get it through Walmart and Target online, but Amazon was probably the primary place to get it. And what it is it's meant to be a personal prophetic mentor and help to answer any questions you might have about the prophetic and help to train you up. You know, there's a lot of places in the country where there aren't prophetic churches or prophetic conferences, or maybe people can't afford to go to those conferences across the country. And so after 24 years of teaching and activating people in prophetic ministry and doing prophetic schools across the country, the Lord had me take all of what I had learned and put it in a book, in book form, so that it could be a personal prophetic mentor to whoever would get it. And so hopefully it'll be a blessing to those.
Just want you to know it's a great book. I've read it. I encourage you to get it. Now, Joni, if we wanted to ask you to come and minister in our city or our town or our state, how can someone get a hold of you?
My email address is joniames@aol.com, spelled J-O-N-I-A-M-E-S at aol.com, or they could go to my website, which is joniames.com, and the information is on there.
Well, this has been a wonderful afternoon, and do go get the book. This is Kay Kent Ministries, and we're giving all honor and glory to the King for His kingdom.